member of Brazil's highest court, ordered any police investigation into Greenwald halted and condemned any such efforts as an unambiguous act of censorship in violation of the country's constitution.
The right of journalists to report on primary source materials documenting official malfeasance is a critically important press freedom issue. The federal prosecutor's office has abused its power by charging Greenwald for doing just that, despite a federal police conclusion that just last month there was no evidence that Greenwald committed any crime in relation to the leaked messages.
Given the Supreme Court's injunction and that federal police conclusion, the federal prosecutor's office's position that Greenwald conspired to commit a crime with his anonymous source is totally unjustifiable. These charges await approval from a federal judge, giving the courts the opportunity to reject them and protect freedom of the press. Even so, the chilling effect of such legal intimidation remains. If these tactics are allowed to stand, it would jeopardize all Brazilians' freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and freedom to participate in democracy.
So that's the letter in English, and then there's a version in Portuguese that we're going to deliver to the embassy. It's signed by many different organizations. It just came out, and many more organizations continue to sign onto it. So we just wanted to read that before we deliver the letter. But we also have people here who are going to speak out, some of them as journalists, to say what they represent for the journalist community. And we want to start out with our good friend Dave Zirin, who's such a fantastic journalist, has connections to Brazil that maybe you could tell us about as well.
Thank you.
Hey, how's everybody doing? All right, we're out here in the cold. That's where we're doing the right kind of work if we're out here, that's for sure. I'm speaking from the heart right now. I traveled to and from Brazil for many years to write a book about the Brazil's hosting of the World Cup and the Olympics back to back, which had never really been done before, particularly since 9/11 with all the security issues. And of course, they hosted the World Cup in 2014 and then the Olympics in 2016. And with it came all kinds of debt, displacement, and militarization of public space. And a person in Brazil who was a great friend to me as I navigated this country that I did not know well was Glenn Greenwald. Glenn was doing this work and helping me, even though at the time he was a vociferous critic of the United States, but at that time he was largely silent about some of the things that were happening in Brazil. He felt like in Brazil, well, this is my home, I'm from the United States, and this is part of Glenn's principles. He said, my primary responsibility is to understand that my real enemy is at home, whether it's the issue of press freedoms, whether it's the issue of empire, whether it's the issue of civil liberties. So he, if you remember, like his ire was trained on the United States. But even with that, and even though Brazil offered him the opportunity at the time under the presidencies of both Lula and Dilma for him to actually have a family in Brazil, to be able to marry his partner David Miranda, which at the time he could not do in the United States, even with all of that, he believed very strongly that as a journalist he needed to help me do my work. And so that's one of the reasons why I'm here today, is because Glenn has been a friend to me. But I also want to acknowledge that, you know, Glenn is not a friend to everybody. And that's one of the things that makes Glenn kind of amazing, to tell you the truth. I mean, there's that old quote about to be a journalist means that you afflict the comfortable. Well, Glenn has never met a comfortable person that he did not want to afflict. And that's part of who Glenn is. And he doesn't care where you are on the political spectrum. He doesn't care who you have stakes with on K Street. He doesn't care what lobbyists you cozy up to. If he feels like you're not acting in the interests of civil liberties and human justice, he is going to go after you. And for Glenn, I think he had a real moment when Jair Bolsonaro, the fascist who represents the embassy behind us, and about as hateful a person as become president this side of the president we have here at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. They call him Mini Trump, but in so many ways he's worse than Trump. In so many ways, he's almost like this virus of Trump. But when Bolsonaro took office, Glenn leapt to the front and said, you know what, I'm not going to let this happen in Brazil. I'm not going to let this happen in my adopted home. I'm not going to let this happen in the place where my own children are being raised without a fight. And Glenn did all of the incredible work that he did to expose malfeasance in the United States and applied it to Brazil. And so that's why I say, like, I like Glenn. I consider Glenn a friend. But whether you consider Glenn a friend or not is totally irrelevant when it comes to this issue. This is about freedom of the press. This is about our right to ply our craft. And frankly, this is about fighting fascism. That's what it's about at the end of the day. For them to attack Glenn Greenwald right like this, it actually makes the forces of fascism stronger if they can shut down voices like Glenn Greenwald. And if Glenn Greenwald is able to emerge at this moment loud and proud and doing the kind of work that Glenn Greenwald has always done, well, then that actually puts the forces of reaction on its heels. And so we're out here to defend Glenn Greenwald. We're also out here to fight fascism. We're also out here to stand with the people in Brazil. We're also out here to stand with everybody on Earth right now who is suffering under the weight of what we could call the new authoritarianism that's taking place in so many countries, not least of all, the United States. So thank you very much. I really appreciate you giving me the space to speak. And you know what, I'll say this. You know, he's not imprisoned at this point, but free Glenn Greenwald. Free Glenn Greenwald, because we want him free to do the kind of work that so desperately needs to be done.
Hands off!
Glenn Greenwald!
Hands off!
Glenn Greenwald!
Hands off!
Glenn Greenwald!
Now we're going to hear from another great journalist who knows the importance of freedom of expression and freedom for journalists, and that is Joe Lauria from Consortium News.
Thank you.
Yay!
Thank you, my dear. Of course, most of you know that Consortium News was founded by Robert Perry, who was one of the best investigative journalists this country has seen. He broke many of the Iran-Contra stories. He gave us the name Oliver North. In 2010, Bob wrote a story defending Julian Assange. It was 2010 was when the Obama administration was considering charging Assange under the Espionage Act. And Bob wrote this piece, extraordinary piece, in which he said that as an investigative journalist, he often encouraged his sources to commit a crime, what would be a smaller crime, to try to prevent a larger crime. And that smaller crime might be stealing a document. He also said, of course, he worked to protect the identity of his sources. That's paramount. Not only because it's ethical, but because you're finished as an investigative journalist. If you reveal your sources, no one will speak to you again. Bob was describing investigative journalism, and he knew what he was talking about. And that's exactly when we read the indictment of Julian Assange, we know that that's what he's being falsely accused of. Now, he was in possession of classified information, and that technically is part of the Espionage Act, a section that needs to be challenged in the First Amendment. But what Bob was saying was that a reporter has to protect the sources and encourage his sources to get more information. The indictment explains exactly what Julian Assange did. He encouraged Chelsea Manning to give more information, and he also helped her to try to enter a database that she had legal access to under an administrative name so that her identity could be identified. That's all he did. He didn't hack anything. Now, what does this have to do with Glenn Greenwald? It's exactly what they are trying to charge Glenn with. We still have a chance to get out of this because it's up to a judge. The Justice Ministry has put forward their allegations, but he hasn't been formally charged yet, so a judge has to decide that. Don't take my word for what Glenn was doing, which was simply encouraging his sources and trying to hide their identity, not hacking anybody. Take the word of the Federal Police of Brazil. They investigated this. They said they found no criminal activity by Glenn Greenwald, and they also said that he actually took many cautions not to cross that line, to be involved in the theft of the email, of the WhatsApp messages in this case. Now, there is a crime at the center of both these cases, Assange and the Bolsonaro case, but that is the theft of materials that's absolutely in the public interest. It was in the interest of the Brazilian public to know that Bolsonaro essentially stole that election. How? Because the judge and the prosecutors colluded, this is what these messages showed, colluded to put Lula da Silva in jail. Lula, of course, was going to stand for re-election. It was almost certain that he would have won, considering his popularity. So Bolsonaro worked with this judge and the prosecutors to get Lula in jail. So while he was in jail, Bolsonaro was elected president. That's the problem here. Of course, Bolsonaro sees Glenn Greenwald as a tremendous enemy because he's exposed the corruption behind his election. So he's trying to do everything he can, either to kick him out of the country or throw him in jail. And that's why we're here in front of the Brazilian embassy right now to rationally argue that this is an extremely dangerous move by the government of Brazil. It cannot stand because journalism is more important than governments, because journalism is supposed to support the public, what the public's interest is, although we see a corporate media that very much supports the governments of the state. And I just want to add one last thing here, that this is coming in the context, Glenn was accused of being a Russian agent and all that because he questioned the Russiagate narrative, as Julian Assange has been smeared as being a Russian stooge, as Bob Perry was called a Kremlin puppet and a Putin asset. And as we have now, Tuesday, we sent libel notices to the Canadian NSA, the Communication Security Establishment, and the Global News Network, because they reported that Consortium News led a cyber influence campaign directed by Russia against Canadian politicians. It's absolute nonsense. So this entire assault on the press is getting worse and worse. On politicians too, as we saw, Tulsi Gabbard now has sued, and Jill Stein has been obviously a victim of these smears. So this is a wider issue than just Glenn Greenwald, but we're here today to tell the Brazilian government to please understand what you're doing and how dangerous this is for your own people. Thank you.
Journalism is not a crime. Journalism is not a crime.
We also represent workers in many, many different industries, including writers and journalists who are part of the National Writers Union that is part of the UAW. We also represent academics. So we're here to show our support for Glenn. He's a hero. What he did was absolutely courageous. We're here to defend freedom of the press. We realize more and more during these times that more journalists are increasingly being disappeared or murdered or arrested. We're against that. We stand with all of you in solidarity, and we hope that Glenn stays firm, stays safe, and continues to do his incredible work in Brazil. And we stand close with the Brazilians as well. Thank you.
Hands up! Hands up! Hands up! Hands up! So next we're going to hear from one of the coordinators of Code Pink's Latin America program, Leonardo Flores.
Hello, thank you. Thanks for everyone for coming out today. We're here not just to defend Glenn Greenwald, but to defend freedom of the press and journalists everywhere. All our solidarity goes out to Glenn and as well to Julian Assange, to Consortium News, that news that the Canadian NSA, called you basically Russian puppets is shocking. And right here in DC, we had journalist Max Blumenthal harassed and falsely arrested by the police. We had independent journalist Alina Duarte, her home was vandalized here in DC, and her family received death threats in Mexico because of the coverage that she was giving to Latin America. And so this isn't a problem that's inherent in Brazil. It's a global problem right now, and it's, as Dave was mentioning, it's a reaction by these authoritarian governments around the world that are trying to stifle information, that are trying to stifle democracy, and that are trying to stifle journalists and citizen activists. In Brazil, it's particularly egregious because, as many of the other speakers mentioned, Glenn Greenwald was one of the key investigative journalists uncovering the corruption within Operation Car Wash. Operation Car Wash is itself an investigation into corruption at all levels of Brazilian society, and it turns out that this investigation itself was deeply corrupt. It was responsible for the ouster of President Dilma Rousseff. It was responsible for the imprisonment of, the false imprisonment of President Lula da Silva. It was responsible for the rise of Bolsonaro in Brazil. Bolsonaro is someone who's been attacking the press since he was elected. The National Federation of Journalists in Brazil recently came out with a statement saying that he attacked the, or threatened the press on 220 occasions in 2019 alone. And he's given no indication that he's going to change his ways, because why should he have to? He's facing no punishment. He's facing no, it's basically total impunity with regards to his attacks on the press. But that impunity won't last forever, because we know that the Brazilian people are going to continue to stand up against Bolsonaro. And that's another of the reasons that we're here today, is to stand up with the Brazilian people as they fight for democracy, as they fight to get rid of this right-wing, you know, quasi-fascist, awful, horrible human being from outside of their presidency. Thank you.
Yay! So we do have a letter that groups all over Latin America and the U.S. are signing right now, and we also want individuals to sign it. And if you're watching this through these various live streams, you can go to codepink.org/Glenn, and it's Glenn with two N's. And sign this letter that is going to the president of Brazil, as well as a number of different officials in the Brazilian government. I'm really excited that we have a number of journalists here today with us. And the next person who's going to speak is a senior analyst with the Institute for Public Accuracy, as well as Exposed Facts, which works with whistleblowers. And that is Sam Husseini.
Yay! Thank you so much, Medea, and everybody else for organizing this. I'll try to be as coherent as possible. I've been working on another story all day. It was wonderful to hear David's remarks and Joe's remarks from Consortium News, especially in our solidarity to Consortium News under their attack as well. I do feel, not to make too much light of this situation, a little odd about the hands-off Glenn Greenwald, because I'm one of those people who occasionally wanted to strangle Glenn Greenwald. But of course, we come together in a time like this when there is a fascist assault on journalism to stand behind somebody who might occasionally, comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. I've known Glenn occasionally to afflict not comfort the afflicted, but be that as it may, he stands accused by a fascist government now precisely for doing what journalists should do, afflict the comfortable, scrutinize the powerful, weed out the corruption, expose things that desperately need to be exposed. We talk about authoritarianism rising globally. Well, that's true. I suspect that the reaction might be different in various quarters if some other government, say the Iranian government or some other might have done something like this to a very prominent U.S. journalist. And we might want to keep that in perspective as to whose ox is being gored. And the whole context, as some have alluded to, about the Bolsonaro government, an effective coup that brought it to power, the environmental degradation, the racism, the homophobia, and the, at times, outright fascism associated with it. One other aspect of this that I'd love to bring up is the other problem of the media is its, I'm going to be very polite and say its failure of major media outlets to do what they purport to do. And that failure, I think, is hand in glove with assaults on actual journalism. That is, actual journalism seems abnormal in a context when things that masquerade as journalism, partisan hackery, celebrity fluff, simple moronicness, simple corporate flackery, military flackery, propaganda for the establishment or establishments of either party, and so on. So I think it's imperative upon us to both defend actual journalism when it's occurring, as with Glenn and Consortium News and WikiLeaks and so on, but to increasingly and more pointedly call out and again, I'm going to be polite, failure of certain alleged media outlets to live up to those journalistic principles that they purport. I don't know how many, I imagine most of you caught the Democratic debate not too long ago. Does anyone recall what was trending on Twitter that day?
No.
During the debate, I should have planted the question. I should have planted the answer with somebody. It was on a certain network, the debate was.
CNN.
Yeah, oh, was it CNN?
Yeah.
That's right. I'd almost forgot. And what did they...
Well, they acted like Bernie Sanders had said that women couldn't win the election. And they acted like he'd actually said it when there was no proof.
Among many other things, CNN sought to demonize Bernie Sanders. And this isn't to endorse everything Bernie Sanders, just like I'm not here to endorse everything Glenn Greenwald. But the thing that was trending, anybody remember it? Nobody else is on Twitter here? It was CNN is trash, lead thing on Twitter at the height of the debate, at least for some of us. We can't. Twitter, one other problem, isn't totally transparent in how they function. So I think we need to be focusing on those other media outlets. So the next debate is sandwiched between Iowa and New Hampshire. The Iowa caucus is in the New Hampshire primary on February 7th. It is on another network called ABC on the 7th. And I suspect it might be a good idea for us to think about scrutinizing ABC the following day, February 8th, at their headquarters in D.C. on DeSales Avenue. We need to play good defense, and sometimes a good defense is a very good offense. And what is bad journalism needs to be exposed desperately. Thank you.